Waukegan, OMC Plant 1, and the city just purchased this building, $525,000, and they're going to tear it down.
The last time I ever visited the plant was April of 2016, and what I saw was a far cry from the place that I loved as a child. The bright silver exhaust stacks that used to reflect the light from the lake had faded to a dull gray, and rust had completely overtaken the Johnson Outboards logo on the water tower. Entire interior rooms had been gutted by copper scrappers, and sections of the exterior wall had been left missing by salvage workers. The plant had been threatened by lakefront redevelopment plans for years, but it wasn't until the August of 2016 that the plant finally came down. Throughout the process, much of the history and significance of the plant had been ignored by the city council and beachgoers alike who touted the plant as an eyesore that had to come down. However, when you start talking to the people who used to work at the plant and reading the comments they've left online, you start to see how special this plant was to the people who spent so many years in it. This video is dedicated to the employees who helped to shape the legacy of Outboard Marine Corporation in Waukegan and who contributed so much of their time to the history of OMC Plant Number 1. The original building was constructed by the Johnson Motor Company after their operation had outgrown the previous plant located in South Bend, Indiana. Ground was broken in 1926, and by 1927, Johnson fully occupied the building. Newspaper articles described the plant as a fine, modern factory of steel and brick construction with daylight on four sides. Only one photo is known to exist of the plant in its original configuration, a 1939 image captured in a countywide aerial photography project. However, this 3D model, created based on blueprints to the original building, helps clarify the original appearance. As originally built, the factory supported five assembly lines, with engineering, accounting, marketing, and executive offices located in a two-story office building facing Lake Michigan. Located at 200 Seahorse Drive, this office structure would come to be known as the 200 Building, and also featured a fully equipped hospital and state-of-the-art fire protection systems. The building remained in this state for a period of 17 years, until the first of many additions to the plant was constructed. When the plant was originally constructed, provisions had been made for an additional set of factory units to satisfy future demands. The call for additional production finally came with the outbreak of World War II in the late 1930s and early 1940s. In 1934, Johnson Motors had been purchased by the Outboard Motor Company, and the new corporation was now tasked with the production of war materials. The newly expanded Waukegan plant was converted to produce bomb fuses, aircraft engines, and firefighting equipment for the war effort. Due to the fact that this addition was pre-planned in 1926, and therefore constructed in the same style, it was difficult to differentiate from the original structure on the exterior of the plant. However, on the interior, the separation was more obvious, as a small section of windows from the original plant remained, and wartime metal restrictions resulted in a heavier use of wood in the construction. While beneficial to the war effort, this decision would one day contribute to the downfall of the plant. Eventually, the location of the technical support department, the excessive use of wood beams in this addition, resulted in the first structural failures of the building in early 2011. After the completion of World War II in 1945, the Waukegan facility was converted back to the production of Johnson Outboard Motors, and major investments were made in plant infrastructure. As seen in this aerial photo, an entirely separate facility was constructed to the west of the manufacturing plant. However, the exact function and purpose of this facility remains unknown. This building was constructed slightly off-center to the rest of the facility, resulting in a noticeable offset on the north side of the plant in future years. The time as two separate buildings was short-lived, and in 1948, a thin building was constructed that reunited the plant as one. This section of building passed directly beneath the original 1926 water tower, such that the legs stood freely through holes in the roof. This resulted in the odd, yet distinctive appearance of the water tower rising from the roof of the building. During construction, the offset left from the 1946 facility was corrected on the south side of the building, resulting in a nearly seamless addition, only evidenced by a small gap in the windows. The last of the post-World War II capital improvements was completed in 1952, bringing the total investment during this time to upwards of $8 million. This addition filled in the gap formed by the previous two additions, eliminating the odd L shape of the plant and reuniting it to one cohesive unit. The 1946 facility received extensive renovations, including the addition of a roof high bay to convert the building to a shipping and quality control space. This allowed each engine rolling off the production line to be run in dedicated test cells, cleaned, and packaged before being shipped. By the late 1950s, it became clear that the current engineering configuration was inadequate. Squeezed into a small space at the front of the aging building, the department was quickly outgrowing their portion of the plant. As a result, in 1959, a massive purpose-built engineering center was constructed behind the 1946 facility. Built on land filled in from Waukegan Harbor, this would be as far as the plant could expand westward. Known as the Product Development Center, or 300 building, the ground floor of this facility provided open floor space and offices for component engineering and machining, 25 state-of-the-art indoor dynamometer and emissions test cells, 13 outdoor durability test barges, as well as a fully equipped boathouse for launching and operating watercraft and motor designs. These accommodations allowed each motor design to undergo rigorous testing in the indoor cells during the prototyping phase, before being finalized and placed on an outdoor test barge for a simulated test run of 6 years. The second floor of the Product Development Center provided large office spaces for the Research and Development Department, as well as drafting, conference, and collaboration workshops along the south end. The north end of the facility held the Pattern Shop and Metal Machining Department, where designs from the R&D department were transferred for the production of prototype molds and castings. During this time, the 200 building also received much-needed improvements. A large wing was constructed around the southern end of the building, later to be occupied by marketing and accounting departments. Additionally, the original facade above the entrance vestibule was replaced in favor of a cleaner, white concrete design. Measuring only around 15 feet deep, this new addition was largely cosmetic, providing only a slightly larger conference room on the second floor, expanded executive offices, and a new lobby configuration. The final addition during this time period introduced a new shipping and receiving facility on the southern side of the plant. No longer relying on a rail connection for shipping service, the Dock 5 facility allowed an entire 53-foot semi-trailer to enter the building at ground level, where workers received the end of the trailer on a raised platform. Extending past the south wall of the plant, the construction of Dock 5 caused some localized controversy. Actually residing on city-owned land, parks groups complained that the new structure set a precedent that would allow further areas of city-owned parkland near the beach to be developed for industrial use. Fortunately for them, the trend would not continue. In its early years, the plant had received a steam supply for heating and assembly processes from the neighboring Waukegan Manufactured Gas and Coke plant.
After the operation was purchased by General Motors Corporation, OMC continued to rely on byproducts from the plant to burn in several boiler house variations that existed throughout the years. As a result of the closure and demolition of the coke plant in the late 1960s and early 1970s, OMC was forced to turn to its own resources to provide steam to the plant. In 1971, three York Shipley steam pack generators were installed on the site of the previous boiler houses. Fed by natural gas, each unit operated at 600 horsepower, producing over 25 million BTUs at high fire. By 1982, the then 56-year-old plant was showing signs of its age, and operations began to wind down. Main assembly was relocated to Calhoun, Georgia, and the vast networks of tracks and assembly lines within the plant were removed. Additionally, the large exterior windows were removed and replaced with cinder block walls, while smaller windows on the high bay roofs and along the post-World War II era additions were coated over with spray foam insulation. The darkened building was then relegated to light machining work, and with the exception of the active 200 building and product development center at either end, the majority of the building sat largely vacant for the next decade. After the removal of manufacturing operations from the plant nearly 12 years earlier, in 1994, OMC made a remarkable decision by investing in a multi-million dollar renovation to convert the then 68-year-old plant to a massive engineering center, nearly doubling the size of the existing product development center and creating an entirely new consumer support area. Construction began with the demolition of interior walls remaining from the numerous additions to the plant, as well as an intensive asbestos abatement in the areas that were to be developed. Completed by the end of 1995, the expanded product development center included shops for wood pattern making, metal machining, hydrodynamics research, electrical system development, environmental stress screening, and an EPA-certified in-house emissions test center. The consumer support offices provided space for the technical service department and manufacturing support department. The latter department would never move into the building, so the space was instead reutilized for environmental compliance offices as well as a makeshift auditorium. Also included was a fully equipped dealer training center. Known shortly as OMC University and later as the Waukegan Training Center, the facility provided classrooms and dedicated test cells for courses offered publicly to dealer technicians and outboard mechanics. Only 3 years after the completion of its new engineering headquarters, OMC shocked employees and the city by announcing the closure of the Waukegan plants in mid-September of 1998. Facing financial hardships and poor management, as well as operating under the shadow of the environmental disaster at the nearby OMC Plant 2, both facilities were to close within 2 years. This would have likely signaled the end of the plant, as within days of the announcement, Waukegan officials began exploring redevelopment plans for the lakefront parcels. However, an unlikely turn of events resulted in the preservation of the building into the 21st century. Two years had passed since the closing announcement, and the move had still failed to begin when OMC filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy on December 20th, 2000. A turbulent and uncertain period followed, until OMC's outboard engine assets were purchased by Bombardier in 2001. Although declining the existing OMC manufacturing plants, the company chose to purchase and reopen the now 74-year-old Waukegan engineering facility. Before new manufacturing options had even been explored, the Waukegan plant was already back up and running, staffed largely by rehired former OMC employees. During this time, the plant was referred to as BMCA Waukegan, with the intention of Bombardier to continue operating the facility for no more than 6 years, at which time the plant would close and the departments would be relocated to a new facility. In 2003, the recreational division of the overly diversified Bombardier, including outboard engine operations, was spun off into a separate corporation, giving rise to Bombardier Recreational Products. By this time, the company now operated a manufacturing facility in Sturtevant, Wisconsin, and the original 6-year plan was maintained. According to the plan, by 2007, the now 77-year-old plant, dubbed BRP Waukegan, would close and operations would be transferred to Wisconsin. As a result, the careful preventative maintenance and upkeep programs of the OMC era were discontinued, a decision that would soon prove disastrous in the final years of the plant's operation. The effects of limited maintenance were seen immediately. In 2004, falling ceiling tiles and roof leaks forced the final occupants of the 200 building to relocate elsewhere. Roof leaks were prolific in other areas of the facility as well, causing BRP to finally approve the application of a temporary 5-year polymer roof sealant to bandage the plant until the company's departure. By 2007, the end of the 6-year plan had arrived, yet it was business as normal at the Waukegan facility. The Sturtevant plant was not yet prepared to accept the engineering departments, and employees were insured an additional 2 to 4 years in Waukegan. Despite this, BRP was still reluctant to approve spending for maintenance on the plant. With the original building now surpassing 80 years, and the comparatively newer product development center approaching 50, maintenance became a chronic issue. By 2009, the temporary 5-year roofing applied in 2004 had expired, and funds for an additional application were denied. As the roof leaks emerged, the maintenance staff attempted a variety of gimmicks to protect the equipment in the plant, including installing massive tarps that were hung from the ceiling to collect and drain rainwater, and plastic kiddie pools placed on the floor to collect the drips. The HVAC equipment had become unreliable as well, as the boilers, chiller, and water pumps exceeded or doubled their operating life expectancy. On January 1st, 2011, BRP released a press statement to Outboard Division employees detailing an $11 million capital improvement project that included plans for the closure of the Waukegan facility. The move was to take place over the next 3 to 5 years. However, only several months later, an emergency forced the company into immediate action. Relying heavily on wooden construction due to World War II and concealed by suspended ceilings, the roof structure of the 1943 edition had been silently failing. During a heavy thunderstorm in the spring of 2011, a section of the high bay roof above technical service gave way, flooding the area in rainwater. Initially, the greatest concerns were regarding mold growth. However, investigations revealed a harrowing truth. An entire section of wooden roofing and windows had detached from the steel high bay supports, falling and coming to rest above the suspended ceiling in a conference room. In danger of further collapse, the department was immediately evacuated. The remaining areas of the facility were still structurally sound, and the relocation of other departments commenced in 2012. Among the last to leave was the durability testing department, who required the outdoor endurance barges to complete motor testing cycles that had already begun. By early 2013, the facility was empty. After the move, the facility was left vacant under BRP ownership for 2 years. The boilers were required during the winter to keep fire sprinkler pipes from freezing, but the facility was otherwise left silent. In February of 2015, the building was sold to Night Owl Holdings, a scrap company out of Detroit. In the months they owned the facility, metal scrappers ripped down the ceilings and tore open walls before leaving the building for dead as vandals took over. This footage, provided by the jonrevProjects, illustrates the conditions in the plant in the months prior to demolition. After the city initially agreed to purchase the building for $1 in June of 2015, court battles and tax disputes delayed the closing of the sale until April of 2016, when the city settled with Night Owl and agreed to pay $525,000 to purchase the facility. The city began soliciting bids for the demolition in May of 2016, eventually awarding the contract to the lowest bidder, Lake County Grading of Libertyville, Illinois. However, the motion to approve the bid was denied by the city council several times throughout the summer. With financial issues plaguing the city, the aldermen were skeptical about investing the $2 million required to pay for the demolition without certainty that the city would see a return. After continued pressure from the Waukegan mayor, the council reversed its position, narrowly approving the demolition contract by a 5-4 vote. Preceded by several weeks of asbestos abatement, demolition of OMC Plant 1 began on August 18, 2016. The work progressed slowly, and the final section of the building fell 5 months later in early January of 2017, a testament to the strength with which the building was built. The future of the site remains uncertain. Only the water tower remains, standing over an empty field. The structure is currently undergoing the landmark nomination process under the approval of the mayor, and there have been rumors that the Johnson logo will be repainted in the near future. Maybe the lakefront redevelopment plans will finally be realized, or maybe the land will sit empty, reclaimed by the grasses and trees that once stood there. Whatever the future holds for the site, the Johnson Outboards Water Tower will still be visible standing over the harbor, serving as a constant reminder of OMC Plant 1 and the legacy of Outboard Marine Corporation in Waukegan.